Hello, Avila Advantage students. We're in our final week, so congratulations. We're almost wrapped up with the course, so just make sure to finish strong this week. Get in there early and post for the final forum discussion. Try to wrap up early. And, of course, you have an exam this week that will be open Thursday, so make sure to get that done and completed by Sunday before midnight because it will close after that. So this week we just have one chapter, chapter 16. I think the good thing about this course is you got exposure to the entire book, which was good. And hopefully when you leave this course, you know, you have a little bit stronger skill set in understanding finance, and especially, you know, with some of the time management, I would call time value calculations, because those are personal finance applications and also at work applications and helping people make decisions about what is best for the company and what is best for yourself. So a little bit of overview this week in your readings. You know, it starts off talking about direct foreign investment. You think about a direct foreign investment would be like Germany comes to the United States and builds plants in South Carolina and North Carolina for their Mercedes-Benz Sprinter van. So they got a huge contract from Amazon for about 20,000 orders. So you'll probably see more of those on the roadway. And I've seen them advertise on television now too, you know, so for about $33,000, you can have this van for your business and we'll equip it any way that you want. So it can also be the United States, you know, we bring in a lot of students from overseas. We don't as much as we used to in the new administration, but that is an example of a service being exported as they are bringing in funds to here. So regardless if the company you work for is very local, regional in nature, we're all touched in some way by international finance. So we're exposed to that. We're exposed to risk. So the first part of this chapter talks about the multinational corporation, and they go into the concepts of foreign exchange rate. And, you know, the idea that, hey, that the price of one currency for the other currency. And I looked today, and in the textbook where it had, you know, the price for a European to buy one American dollar was about 0.88 of euro. And that was the same in the textbook as it is today. So going back to 2015, it hasn't changed too much. But in terms of American wanting to buy a euro, it cost $1.13 to buy 1 euro. So let me explain a little bit about appreciation and depreciation. If the euro is depreciate in value, that means that it's going to cost more for an American to buy it. So instead of $1.13, perhaps it goes to $1.20. So if the American is having to pay more and the euro is appreciating, that must mean that the U.S. dollar is depreciating. Okay. So in theory, a lot of these currencies, they should all balance out, even though some are getting more expensive, less expensive. They talk about in the textbook about interest rate parity and the law of one price. So if people are looking for investments and they see a higher real rate of return in Europe, what should happen in theory is that more people are going to want to buy the euro. But as the euro appreciates, the return on that investment is going to decrease to level out to parity in the world. We can look at this as products too. There's always in The Economist, they look at the Big Mac Index. So what is the price of a Big Mac in the United States versus a Big Mac in Paris? And in theory, you should be able to exchange your dollars for euros and go to a McDonald's in France and buy that Big Mac without having to come up with more money or have extra money to save. But that is not always the case. There's not always parity, so there are lags and other variables that are happening there. So the textbook doesn't necessarily talk about this, but corporations can hedge themselves. They mention that, but there are ways you can do it, like an options contract, a futures contract, or even swaps. They use some examples in the textbook from a seller and buyer, but I'll use an example of somebody like a farmer trying to sell wheat. The wheat farmer is worried about the price he or she is going to receive 6 months from now. So what the wheat farmer can do is get an options contract and have a put that is the right to sell wheat at, say, $5 a bushel 6 months from now. So that way, as long as it drops in price to $4.50 or $4, he still gets to sell it at $5. So somebody has to underwrite that contract and be willing to take the risk. Somebody buying wheat can do it on a call option. So they're worried about the price going up. So they can kind of hope to lock in a price that they're guaranteed to buy at least that price. Another technique is a way that the farmer could do in the futures market. The futures market is a risk. Basically, you're taking a bet which way direction of price is going to go. But as long as you have an underlying asset, such as wheat or a currency, then it's okay because it's going to be offset. But going back to that wheat farmer again, he could bet that the price is going to go down for his wheat in the future. That's called going short. When you go long, you're betting the price is going to go up. So if right now it's at $5 and he's worried that it's going to drop, well, he can go short. So if it does go down to $4, he wins on that margin contract. He loses on the wheat, because when he goes to the market and sells it, he's going to get a lower price, but he's going to win on the contract. So it's just hedging, you know. So if you don't have an underlying asset, you're simply just gambling, and that is high risk. But some people do that, and you can quickly lose a lot of money or make a lot of money, depending on which direction the prices go. And, you know, the focus here is more on currency. So there are people that speculate on the currencies and which prices that they're going to go to. Okay, and then the last is just a swap, but there may be swaps of agreements between interest rates and currencies that you work out with through a broker, and you agree to exchange one currency for another, and then you may settle out at some point in the future or as interest rates changes. Somebody that may have a variable rate on a loan and somebody that has a fixed rate on a loan, for various reasons, may want to swap those with each other so that they position themselves to get that fixed rate and avoid the variable changes, or the other person wants a little bit more flexibility to have the variable rate. So it's actually a large existing market. Well, that's it for this week. So I want to wish you a happy holidays. I'll try to wrap everything up with the course quickly, get everything graded out there within a few days. But other than that, if you do have any questions, do send me an email, and I look forward to talking to you online this week.